Welcome, everybody, back into your coverage of WEC. We are in our lower bracket, round two, and possibly the final game coming out from this round. If Newbie are capable of taking the victory, they'll get themselves almost a revenge match. The winner of this game will go up against EG in the next round, the lower bracket. Newbie are one game up after able to defeat a Tinker, would you believe, being played by LGD. Into the game we go, everyone. This is actually a game which we weren't expecting to get to cast, but considering we had ourselves a nightmare. At GG, we had some time. Jumped inside the lobby as well, so greetings to everyone inside the Dota TV, and the man who was meant to cast it all is now actually going to join me, as Bulber is passing out in his American time zone, and Quaver had to pop out as well, as he only just woke up out of bed, and Bulber dragged him in unwillingly. No, he is willing. But I'm joined by Gorgon, the wonder of cows. Welcome to the broadcast, man.
Thanks. I'm glad to be here. Just getting out of a little crisis zone of my own, as my electricity went out for a little chunk of the night due to a storm passing by, and it came back on right in the middle of that last game, which was a flurry of emotion for me. Like, as my clock is coming back on in my kitchen, I'm scrambling to try and get the stream going for everybody. But we got about 5 minutes at the end of last game, so everybody should have a general idea what was going on here, and we've got hopefully the good best of three ahead of us.
I'm looking forward to one, man. I'm looking forward to one. I was looking forward to a really good game between Na'Vi and EG, and I gotta say, it was good for EG. Oh, it was so good for EG. That was brilliant. As far as this game goes, though, let's focus ourselves in on just Newbie versus LGD. So, Newbie won game up. They must be feeling confident going into this one, and they actually get one of the heroes, which teams were in fact banning out in the first two against them. Just because they fear what Newbie are capable of doing with this hero. Reserve and time. That's going to be the Enchantress. And they actually get the double whammy too. It's a Centaur plus an Enchantress together. At the same time, LGD get the favorite first pick hero in the tournament so far, which is the Shadow Shaman.
Yeah, it's interesting too, just jumping from American Dota to Chinese Dota, you immediately see the high priority on that Enchantress that you just don't see in any other region other than that specific.
It's not even for China though, it's only for Newbie. Like, it's only for Newbie. Like, it really is only for them. There's very few other teams in China which I've seen picking an Enchantress, even considering picking an Enchantress. But Newbie just love the hero.
Well, they do some wonderful things with, and everybody can remember exactly what Newbie's been doing through TI, before TI. And this is really one of their big standout performances coming out after TI, and I expect that all the trends will continue.
Well, for now, man, I'm still interested to see if this Newbie roster is capable of actually achieving more than a lower bracket semifinal position. Considering these guys are the winners of TI, they changed their roster up. Zhao 8 didn't fully retire. He ended up going off to help out other new talent in the Chinese scene and create his own team. Actually got to cast them going in for the qualifiers. Actually, they were in MSI Beat It's matchup, in fact. They ended up losing during their grand final. They got firmly stomped by a team called Wings. But, yeah, so he's gone on to bigger and better things. realizing the more I say that, I make it sound like it's a disaster. He's helping people that need to get better at Dota, but they lost.
He's helping the underprivileged of the Dota world.
Maybe that's
of the Chinese Dota world.
Reserve he's like, come time. On, you can be like me one day. Married, have a successful career, winning $10 million tournaments or $11 million tournaments. Be like me, boys. Be like me.
And I will show you how Newbie and LGD are actually taking a lot of time out of their reserve for these bans.
Okay, no, they didn't disconnect.
Yeah, they are still here.
I don't know if you tuned in to the broadcast yesterday. But it happened three times on the main stage match when Na'Vi played Cloud9. It happened three times. The base camp and I just sitting there going, "Why the hell are they taking so damn long?" And it's just because they all disconnected.
Wow. Well, that's not the case here. They are here. They're just taking a good deal of time thinking about what they want. Morphling being banned out along with the Invoker. Still, actually, LGD is running their reserve time absolutely thin. They've got 25 seconds left for the remaining three picks and two bans. Really abnormal to see a team go that low this early on in the draft.
Well, the decision was hard. The decision was quickly LGD counted. Brewmaster was the band out, which would have been probably it would have been the mid solo for Newbie. Instead, though, we get Moose Templar Assassin arrive.
Yeah, that's a pick that we've been seeing a little bit more often. Obviously, on Moo, it makes a ton of sense as well. He's very, very strong on that hero. The Brewmaster being banned out is not surprising at all, considering he's one of the top three most picked heroes in professional Dota since TI. I think he's actually sitting at number three exactly, if my memory serves. So, Doombringer is the only thing that makes me a little uncertain about that is they already have the Doom, who is like the hard counter, and the Skywrath is still in the pool, who is another really strong counter to that brew. So I'm kind of surprised that they're so concerned about it, considering how well fitted they are for dealing with the Brewmaster. But that will end up being their much awaited pick, and they've got 5 seconds to decide what they want. They're going to go for an IO.
I'm going to answer your question right now on the Brewmaster. As a person who casted Moo actually quite a lot recently, he's one of these guys that jumps in and in the late game won't even bother to clap. He just goes straight into the split. So his brewing, it just becomes a positional thing for the Lion. Split. And it's one of these things where you can pick up Skywrath as well as Doombringer. And actually saw him play up against exactly those two heroes, and still in every single fight he got his split off. And in fights, which he didn't in the later portion, like the late portion of the game, like maybe, I think it was like one or two times he actually got the Doom on him, he just tanked it. Because the thing about the Brewmaster, you can stop him from doing the split, but if the rest of your team still does the work, you're fine.
Yeah.
You're absolutely fine.
You're not usually relying on the Brewmaster in that late portion of the game anyway, right? He's there to carry your team into a strong mid-game stance, where in the late game the team can come together as a whole, usually under the banner of some other hero. He by the time you get into that late portion where it's just so much easier to take him out before he manages to get that primal split, you're not usually relying on the primal split very heavily.
I don't know if it was something we said. I didn't hear it.
5 seconds.
But did
remaining.
Someone freak the chat out for a moment?
Yeah, I don't know. Everybody is saying wow reserve and refraction.
You gotta do it right, man. You gotta do it right. Come on.
Wow! And refraction! Is that... yeah.
Infliction's a little bit wrong. It's wow! There you go. Gotta channel it. Channel it, man.
that 3 o'clock a.m. Twitch chat channeling during the draft. And once again, an exceedingly long draft. Well, Lion coming out once again, this time on Newbie. Ember Spirit is going to be out there for LGD. Gaming's
turn to ban. I actually want to tell a story before we finish this up. Before the draft actually completes. This happened 2 years ago. For people who don't know, the Dota TV audio, Newbie's it used to be completely to shite. Like, horrendously shite. And when they were doing the documentary free to play, the audio for the commentary was so bad that they didn't want to use it in the documentary. So we had to re-record all of the audio, all the commentary from the International One. So I spent a week in Seattle re-recording all the matches. And what we ended up doing think about it is, like, you got to get yourself in the mood, find the right tones. We started with day one's games on day one, and we worked our way through, and I pushed myself every single night to make my voice as sore as it was during TI1, so you'd have exactly the same feel for the grand final games and for the other big games. Yeah, I had to force, I had to tear my throat up a little bit because we were casting like 12, 14 hour days then. It was a lot of Dota with no breaks. There wasn't the luxury of having multiple casters. So just a story if you guys were wondering what happened with the commentary for We to Play and you wondered like how the hell did that audio actually sound so much better than the original TI1 audio. That's the reason why.
And all of Berlin stayed up that whole week with you. Just listening to the remakes of the TI1 audio.
No. I was recording that in Seattle. I traveled to the Valve offices for that one. Yeah, we did it in one of their studios there. In the meantime, though, our draft has finished, so we get a Weaver pickup from Newbie. They're realizing right now, too, that there's very little control on that Weaver unless Doom gets the Doom off. And once the Lincoln Sphere is up on Howl, there shouldn't be a major problem with that. The major problem is probably going to be more along the lines of how can they deal with the Ember Spirit? And that, I think, goes a lot into the hands of Rabbit. They need to get his Blink Dagger, the Hoof Stomp on him, and Moon needs to be right behind Rabbit to ensure he can be there for the Meld Strike into Refraction damage. Because the damage output from Newbie is going to be really damn good in that mid-game.
Oh, yeah. Not just the damage output. Both physical and magical damage output are just staggering for the squad coming into the mid-game. With the Centaur, the Lion to back it up. And, of course, the Weaver just starts out the game with so much damage and is so maneuverable. It's very difficult to lock him down. Fortunately for LGD, they do have two of the stronger counters to the Weaver before he gets his Lincolns, the Shadow Shaman and the Doom.
In July, TP'd himself up right now. Now, Hal's going to do as much damage as he possibly can, but this is a boots first, Nature's Prophet. He's got a body block up in July, so Sunshine can get himself in range for the Earth Spike. He'll be able to connect on that one. They don't have enough damage to bring him down, and in July, will walk. Actually, he could just TP himself back to base now. But it's going to flag his very aggressive movements. He blocks up the three Enchantress camps that she wants to be using here, and then leaves a nice vision ward, and it's not in a position where you probably would throw a D ward for. Actually, yeah. You would. If you just threw the one on the side here, you'd probably claim it then. But it's still really good vision for the offlane for in July, and they fed him four sentry wards, and he actually did put down his fourth sentry ward, blocking the side pull camp.
Brilliant.
And you're seeing Banana, he's making the wise choice. He's trying to move into the Radiant jungle now. And Yao, as well as MMY, are already waiting for him.
The second you see early rotation up, especially out of that Nature's Prophet, where you know he's had as much time as he wanted moving around that jungle, the first gut reaction you have to have is move into your opponent's jungle and try to get whatever you can there. And Banana's actually going to move back into his own jungle and just see if he can find anything worth keeping. As it turns out, there's not a camp.
He's got one. That's
he's got the easy camp, yeah.
It's not the camp he wants to have either, because there's no creep there, which would actually help him. Sunshine's got something which is helpful, and that's going to be an Invis rune. So if he wants to, we can go for the stun on Sylar. He'll have to wait out the Flame Guard, however, before he can go on this. But they're bringing the Centaur over, and Centaur, he's in range for, well, a Hoof Stomp, but then in comes the Wisp. Remember, Sunshine's still here, so then stun on Sylar. Hoof Stomp, Meld Strike, Sylar. A huge amount of damage coming his way early on, but it's not enough. MMY keeps himself tethered up, and Rabbit, he came too deep under the tower. The creep wave will take the kill, so it won't count as first blood. It all gets split, however. 409 gold split between LGD. But the first kill goes the way of LGD.
Very nice for Newbie, at least that wasn't the first blood bounty. But even so, losing that hero so early on, it's really rough. Especially considering how much they invested in moving in there for that early gank into the mid. They had two heroes rotate through just to make sure that they'd have that. And as it turned out, it just wasn't enough.
Mm-hmm. And more waste of time as well, because Banana, not into any jungle which he can use. He's now finally moving down south. But they're gonna spot him out. There's already an observer ward looking for that. So MMY might be thinking about harassing him out of the lane. In the meantime too, I just want to flag the fact that Faith is actually running what we can now class as a core shaman. Banana's also gonna go down. Prophecy being in for this one. They have more than enough damage. 2-0 now in favor of LGD.
And that is that first blood.
That it is. Out,
so. Very nice. I'm not 100% sure why Newbie has prioritized having both their wards on the same corner here. That seems a little bit over enthusiastic about this river spot and this rune vision. I don't know if you've seen this before, because I've never seen this.
The observer warding positions is really, really off, because there's no point putting both of them that close. Like, even this observer ward, which is on the cliff, you could just move a little further south to be actually visible, so you can see the tree line on the side. So you'd be watching MMY, for example, rotating in like he is at the moment. But, man, I can't believe how quick the Shadow Shaman's going to come online with the Doombringer, who, like, it's Yao as well. Like, Yao is, like, would be your core in the lane normally, but Faith takes all the farm in the lane. He hits level 4, and he's worked perfectly up against this Centaur. Rabbit's got 5-0 up against a 13-2 Shadow Shaman at the moment. And Shadow Shaman's going to crack level 6 within the first 5-6 minutes.
And that rotation out of Rabbit early game cost him so much as well and gave the early start off to Faith, making sure that he's going to have everything he needs in order to keep the Centaur zone, make sure he's a safe distance away from the hoof stomps, and get up a very early six with minimal support rotations into his lane, meaning that he's going to get it up even faster. The smoke is coming out here. Shancheng is trying to move in on the Doombringer, it looks like. They're not going to be able to secure that kill.
No. And even Banana with one creep, he managed to steal as a one creep he doesn't want in the early game. An Alpha Wolf. Hey, you want to have some level of disable or control. And you do not get that from the Alpha Wolf, just damage. The one thing which is still working greatly for newbies, so like for everything which has been happening, we could say, hey, yeah, it's two kills the way of LGD. Wonderful, like wasted rotations. Banana's not finding anything. But you're still getting a Weaver who's 23 for 12. Your Doombringer is finding some farm because of Devour, but that's basically all you really got. Oh, Banana. He cuts his way through the Sprout. She can't follow him. The Sprout works against LGD for the moment. And Banana, he's already gone for his heal, but then Sunshine needs to get this stun off and catches all three. The Sprite still do a little bit of extra work, but Sunshine saving his teammates, including also stopping Faith from getting any kind of Hex or Shackles onto Rabbit.
Just great play. Just great play coming out of Shancheng. And it looked for a second there like the Centaur moving down as well. They thought about potentially moving in on that with the Nature's Attendance working. I'm really glad that they decided to play it a little bit more safely with the Centaur kind of backing out and just letting the Lion move in, do the work, get that stun, and protect it. Newbie doesn't need to overextend right now, especially because they're playing a little bit from behind. They have the Weaver farming. They have Mu coming in pretty well as well, sitting at second on terms of CS. And they just want to make sure they can try to ride that out without giving any more of an advantage to LGD. Get up their core items before they go into that mid game where they're very strong, rather than overemphasizing this early game where they're a little bit weaker.
Yeah, I was coming in for Sunshine. Faith gonna start with the Shackles, the Hoofstone from Rabbit. Yes, she canceled the Shackles so he get a shock off, but then Sunshine gets the Hex and walks away. 5 life points, got himself out of range of that Scorched Earth. While Hal TP's in just at the right time, and Hal will be killing off Yao at the moment if he can find just enough damage. He runs down, he's still got time lapse available here. A little bit more damage, there's your time lapse out. Chikuchi, he runs through MMY, he's committing, he's off to the side, the Spirit Balls! They're trying to find him, they're moving out. Hal's got Chikuchi, 1 second. Munt is on the tangos, he's searching for Yao to just be walking back off the lane. Instead he'll find In July, attacks him once, but he's got no mana for a Chikuchi. He's short, there you go, switches to Intel Treads. Runs down, runs up. Where are you going, Hal? You're not gonna live through this. One more attack, Faith comes in from the sidelines. And Weaver, there were multiple choices when he could have just like run west and gone up through the rune area and bailed out of that one. But instead he keeps 4 heroes on that bottom lane trying to kill him off. And they're successful. And then Faith is level 6, Mass Serpent Wards, tier 1 tower, belongs to LGD.
Yeah, that's brilliant. With Faith especially getting that level 1 out of that core position so quickly because he didn't really need any supports in his lane. His supports were rotating around. Level 6 at 6 minutes with Shadow Shaman is much scarier than level 6 out of like a support role or even a level 6 at like level 7 or minute 7 or 8 where you might see a more mid Shadow Shaman. There's nobody on newbie who can really handle the damage output of those Serpent Wards. So if they go down on a tower right now, the tower pretty much has to be dropped.
Got a newbie forcing a tier 1 tower on the top lane. Nature's Prophet's going to TP up here and try and slow him down, but they had a Centaur on the front lines. They'll try and make it so the Catapult did most of the work for him on this lane, while the Satyr dragged the creep wave over to the side. And they have managed to bring this tower down half of its life points, but now newbie realized they can't do much more there. But Mu's still really happy with this. Okay, the Ember's got himself some really good farm. Not going to deny that. But Mu hasn't died yet. The TA hasn't been focused at all. And a Templar Assassin with momentum is a very, very scary thing that LGD will have to be facing. You said it perfectly a couple of minutes ago. Newbie just waits for their items to come and their timing to arrive. With both those things hitting, you're good to go.
Mu's
gonna be careful. Mu, stop napping! Stop napping! Oh, he melds. He strikes pretty hard onto Syla as well, but then Mu shackled, hexed, and then the spirits from Syla. He knew how much he can get away with just then. But he just sat there and let him walk in range of the Shackles.
Meanwhile, in the top lane, Hao dives pretty deep in order to get the Nature's Prophet, who tried to dig himself into that jungle but was unable to on the west side.
Oh, the Troll Trap! And the Enchant as well, but Faith doesn't really care by the looks of it. He's got Arcane Boots, he's happy with the spam, he's got Mass Serpent Wards if things get rough.
Yeah, and there was no follow-up coming out. I mean, look at Shawshank. He's got 165 health, enough for one Earth Spike. There's really nothing on Howe either. He walked away from that engagement on the Nature's Prophet, having been beaten and battered by that Tier 1 tower. He walked away with probably about 90 health himself. So even though there was maybe a little bit of overpresence by that Shadow Shaman, there's just no way for Newbie to punish it there.
LGD are going to punish Newbie. Mass Serpent wants down on the Tier 1 tower. You got quick wards, you got quick Tier 1s.
Yeah, then once again, there's nothing Newbie can do. They can't walk into these wards. They're just too strong relative to the hero's HP pools Dyer's right now. And even though, arguably, if those wards had come out maybe 2 or 3 minutes later, Newbie would be able to try to defend some of these towers, maybe farm up a little bit of the wards after a good engagement. Woo, Shaoshang is going to go
really?
Down.
Really? Why?
Dyer's middle tower is under attack.
I don't think the Doom was really required there from Yao. Like a level death and Sylar running up, it would have got the kill, but because he doomed up, it allowed Newbie to get the denial.
Yeah. They are going to try to apply some pressure on this tower while the lion's gone, but the respawn timer is just so low right now that it doesn't even matter. Like, especially with that deny, that gives you nothing except the cooldown timer on the Doom, which is really a win for Newbie.
No, just sometimes, like, if that Doom was still up then, they could have actually cast it over on the move, and they could have forced the mid-tower out a lot more.
Yeah.
Just
no,
being
I totally
a little bit
agree.
More efficient with your abilities. Maybe yeah, that's just me. I'm getting picky, man. I'm getting picky.
I 100% agree. He was so close to that. Even if they didn't manage to kill him, it's a support lion. Like, let him go back to the fountain and have to heal while you're pushing down on that tower. That would honestly probably take longer than him respawning with full health. If you just forced him back to the fountain to stand there and heal and then TP back and he had to run all the way back to the fountain, you would have had more time with a 4-on-5 engagement anyway. It would have been even better off. So, I don't know.
How maybe I need to be picky. He's going to get Sirin chained up. He's considering chasing a little bit further right there. He's still got time left available, and with the Shikuchi through, he will be able to get it. But he had time left before. Just at least force out a couple of bottle charges out from the Wisp, including his stick charges. While on bottom lane, Centaur Ult is going to be used. They come in for the Earth Spike with the double edge. There's still a Hoof Stomp available, and Rabbit, he's too late on it. Actually, didn't connect on Yao. And because of that, the Prophet Ult bounces through. The Doom turns on the Scorched Earth. They take 2 kills. The Doom is back off cooldown. And Faith, this man has Mass Serpent Wards up. And they're pinging the Tier 2 tower already. Sylar can hold the top lane, even up against the Enchantress Creeps. And for all the farm that Mu's getting is having no influence on this map whatsoever.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, bear in mind, we're only 10 minutes into this game. And the fact of the matter is, LGD is skyrocketing into this mid game, and Newbie is kind of putting along. They've required all their farm.
They're coming into mid. They're looking at Mu. There goes your Doom we're talking about. Slider fist into a Searing Chain. Sylar, he actually TP'd himself in for this one. They're going to go straight back to pushing the bottom lane because the Relocate's going to drag him there. I believe Ember's actually got a spirit there too. Actually, no, it looks like MMY and Faith will just be here. Their Mass Serpent Wards went down, but they didn't get the tower. In fact, the wards just end up being farmed up here by Howe and Sunsheng.
Radiant's yeah, top that's is that under 2 minutes later. Remember, 2 minutes later, if those wards had come out, they're able to farm them if they take a decent engagement or if there's not the enough committal by LGD. And Howe going to come down and get a fair amount of gold off of those wards. I don't really know that the wards needed to be dropped there, although they did get a healthy amount of this tower's health, which means you get that tower HP down low, then you're able to rat it a little bit. Roshan is a much easier prize, closer to the 20-minute mark.
Mu's in trouble. Mu's in a lot of trouble. The Hex to start with. Okay, I don't know why he shocked first. If they just went for the Shackles, he would actually tick through the defensive refraction charges first, and then the shock would have had an effect. But instead, he just does a bit of a fake initiation onto Mu. Forces a TP out, but Rabbit goes straight into the jungle to farm up. This man is... desperately trying to get his blink dagger on that centaur.
If Newbie have been having trouble up to this point, they're about to have a lot more trouble as the real big first ticket items out of LGD are going to start dropping into the game very soon. The mechanism is going to be done on Nature's Prophet in 300 gold, less than 300 gold, which means that these pushes are going to become a whole lot more stable and a whole lot more difficult to push off coming from Newbie. Meanwhile, Newbie is not even yet sitting on completed treads for all of their heroes, and they are still quite a ways off of their first big ticket items. So the window of their, oh, we're down just basically on experience and we're having a little bit of trouble with that, that's about to close, and the window of we're down a whole set of items, an entire tier of items, is about to open up.
Radiant's bottom tower. Oh, there goes your tier one. Dyer's top tower. Committal again. Attack. Don't care about it. They just drop the Mass Serpent Wards down. Hal's already TPing off that bottom lane. He doesn't want to stick around for that.
Dire's top tower has fallen.
Again, though, this is one of those like efficiency kind of things. You had an army of trees. You already had a high amount of pushing power. And now, well, Nubi, they try and just go for a quick Roshan. When you go to Templar Assassin, why not?
Yeah, especially because if they don't take it now, they might not have another opportunity to use that dire advantage. Right, they're very quickly looking at our tier 2s could be dropping soon. This is could be our last chance to really take this, and if things go wrong down there, we'll have the TP reaction. They are going to manage to get it a little surreptitiously.
The Doombringer's actually brought down line on the bottom lane because he's just sitting out in the middle of nowhere. Banana's going to get shackled up and controlled. The Slide of Fist also coming in and move. Well, that was a nice Mel Strike, but then the Meg Charge instantly refreshes out the damage. Faith will go down. Hal unable to actually time-lapse out in this one. And Mu, he'll go down too. That Aegis the Immortal they freshly claimed will already be broken. Not to mention the other three heroes that die around him. And then double Blink Daggers arrive. One for the Centaur, finally here. And the other one, well, that was the Dooms, wasn't it?
Yeah, I think so. He's taking a look, and he is coming out. Yeah, he probably has not bought anything recently because he's sitting on 1,300 gold.
I saw two Blink Daggers. One was the TA. It was the TA and the Centaur. Same team.
There you go.
Same team.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Just the flash in the bottom right. It's easy to miss it.
I'm only halfway through the day right now, too. That makes me concerned.
I have an excuse. It's 3:30 a.m. where I am. Come on, Toby.
It was 9 o'clock in the morning. I've been up since 1. So,
yay. Well, there you go. So, yeah, halfway
bottom lane
through
gonna
the
fight.
Day.
That rough, rabbit blink deck is really going to come in handy right now. And he's looking for the opening. He got a double. It's over an MMY. Finger of Death ensures that Wisp is on the sidelines from the get-go. And then Mu tries to go to town. Slide of Fist doing some decent damage. But now also Yao standing his ground. The Enchantress getting ripped apart. And so will the Centaur. Hal is still running around searching for this kill over on the poor little shaman. Shikuching Magdu is able to claim it. The Wisp did buy back into this engagement. And now Hal, he got Slide of Fist and Searing Chain, locked in. The tier 2 tower is gone. And there's 15-5 on the board. The only buyback that came out through that one was from MMY. And LGD will now just move themselves out. And they're looking 15 minutes in with only one remaining tier 2 tower to bring down.
The real question comes out here, was it worth Weaver to dive in to try and make sure he takes down that Shadow Shaman? Granted, it's a core Shadow Shaman, which is not the normal case when you see somebody dive in, you grab a Shadow Shaman, you normally expect, oh, he's going in for a support and it's probably not worth it. But even so, the Weaver manages to grab him, maybe manages to push it back, but he knew that the Serpent Wards were down. So he knew that Shadow Shaman wasn't going to be effective in a push right away anyway. Maybe you back off and just try to find some farm. I don't know. Nubi is in an exceedingly difficult situation right now, though. They're about 10,000 gold in deficit, about 3,000 experience in deficit, which is not nearly as much of a problem.
It looks like they're getting ready to fight mid. Banana, Sunsheng, and Rabbit. They're just waiting for someone to come out too far. Fate's waiting it out, though. He's got 15 seconds until Mass Serpent Wards are there, and they're pinging out Howl on the top. But the Defensive Observer Ward up on this top will instantly scout it out. So this Blinking Doom is not going to hit its target.
Yeah, he's looking for it. He's trying to get in position, but yeah, just look at Hal running exactly the opposite direction. He knows what's going on.
But this isn't where he needs to be, though. He runs away from the gank, but when the Mass Serpent Wards are up from Faith and you have a catapult behind him, they're going to keep losing out of towers. And Hal's walking around with 2.2k gold. The blink comes in. They don't have detection for him, though. But with all of this, like, you're still going to lose that top tier. Top tier 2. Is under
attack. Hal actually takes the time to save all the way up for his ultimate orb.
Perfect sprout. Centaur couldn't reach him. The stun will go from Sunshine, but they knew that if they didn't hit the initial stun going in behind that tier 1 tower, they had to bail out straight away because they already used Centaur ultimate. Under attack.
Yeah, that was some really good discretion there. They realized that the Nature's
position, man. He was looking for the courier as he TP'd in. Sorry.
no problem at all. They realize they're going to be able to get this tower, right, down bottom, even if they don't get the Nature's Prophet. So a little bit of discretion goes a long way there. Nubi finally getting themselves up on the board in terms of tower control. That little bit of gold can help them also try to complete some of their open ticket items. They've still got Blink Dagger on two of their heroes. The Ultimate Orb is now out on the Weaver, so they're starting the stats up a little bit. Also an Ogre Club for survivability on the Templar Assassin. Pretty soon, those are going to be built into their first big ticket items, which will help close some of this gap in terms of actionable items. But they're going to have a very small window after they close that gap before it opens up again. And LGD is sitting on top of tier 2 items while Newbie is still sitting with their fresh tier 1s.
Yao's still looking to go solo up here. Maybe the Observer Ward's giving him a little bit too much confidence.
he knows what's going on. He sees it.
When Lion's just behind him and Rabbit with the Blink Dagger, I'll be concerned. He can easily get counter-initiated and just give a lot of farm experience over. Because right now he is actually with that... Well, he's still actually got a Devour. But he's tied for the top net worth with... Okay, there he goes. He actually caught up to Yao. No Scorched Earth, though. He doesn't have the movement speed. The Relocate's coming in, but they're too far away. Scylla, he needs a Slide of Fist and Searing Chain. Or he could just do that. Orb himself in. Got the Searing Chain off. Mu will come in. They actually evaporate the Wisp as well as Yao. And this is the damage output, which I thought LGD had to give a little bit more respect to. Spirit's still going to be there for Scylla. He's getting hexed up. Faith with the extra shock as well. It's 3 heroes for 2 heroes right now. And Faith, the Shackles. That's not going to work. Rabbit comes in for a Hoofstop. The Mouse Serpent Wars are down. But Mu, Scylla, Slide of Fist. He actually jumped up into the central to get the kill. But the Mountain hit from Mu gives him such a big strike. He can complete his entire BKB now of just this fight.
And that was the sound of that window closing for LGD. That was the sound of that window slamming shut on them. The items are starting to come out for Newbie, and they can actually assert themselves a little bit, at least for a couple of minutes here while LGD gets ready for their next big surge. Especially considering, we may not have mentioned this, but Yao did go for a Midas, which has offset his early game potential a little bit into more of a mid-game, late-game potential. And man, Mu came into this mid game. We said he was going to come into it strong, and you just saw the damage output that he has at this stage. Now that he's got BKB, he's definitely going to be able to do a lot more in way of trying to deter LGD from these really aggressive pushes.
Normally I could have said too, like that Midas would have actually delayed Yao, but I think it's actually a bit of a different kind of thing in this game, because technically he started off as a jungler in this game, running the Midas as well as the Devour, and then the bonus gold he got in from the towers is basically pushed this game to be where you're running, I'm not going to say two cores, because Faith took a backseat after he got the early levels. But I'd actually say the Doombringer is still going to be just as strong here in the mid game as he normally would be, because he's going to get his BKB now as he finishes up these creeps.
Yeah, I think as he runs around toward that 22-minute mark, actually, he's going to get that BKB a little earlier than I expected, but yeah. Coming around that like 20 to 25-minute mark, he's going to come in about as strong as he would have been anyway. And that, if you get an early Midas, that's about the time that you might expect that to happen anyway, especially if you have the Devour on your side. Moving in around that 30 to 35-minute mark, he's going to be a little bit stronger than he would have been anyway because of the extra experience that he gets out of the Midas, and then after that, it's all gravy, right? But through the early game, that was Newbie's Radiant's opportunity in order to take advantage of this attack. Doom and try to push in, but they just have not had any luck in terms of their engagements.
I don't know how they're supposed to have luck in these engagements. Unless Mu just burst damages down somebody and turns the engagement, Newbie can't win the fight. Because you're not going to get it from the Enchantress. The Enchantress has been useless most of the engagements. She's just struggling to build anything.
It comes down to the fact that she got completely offset through that early game. Remember, she had no camps in her jungle to open up with, which completely set her back. That's like, imagine if you were allowed to go into a lane, but not until 2 minutes into the game, right? That's basically what they did to Banana. So it's not surprising that Banana's been significantly less useful this game than one might normally expect Banana's Enchantress to be. It was just a really strong play coming out of LGD. In every lane, they managed to take control and just put their heroes in the position that they need to be.
LGD was searching for a move right then. They're hoping they'll catch out at Hal. We're just a little bit too far away from the rest of his teammates, but he runs down south. He's searching for more farm, maybe even looking for a pickoff as you see in July in this mid lane. But at the same time, this four-man movement from LGD is going to find nothing from Newbie. Newbie were moving between the Radiant Jungle and their own ancient area back up to the top lane of their base. They're basically everywhere where LGD was not.
Injuli is going to go for this more modern build on the Nature's Prophet with the Blade Mail to give him that survivability in lane and make it that deterrent for Newbie to push him away too hard. Basically having that Blade Mail says, especially with the mechanism, which gives him that extra burst of health, says if you want to stop me from split pushing, you need to send two heroes. You can't just send one. And forcing them to run around to shove their thumbs in the holes in the dike, it's just going to continue to reduce newbies' ability to get gold. It's going to continue to reduce newbies' ability to get the experience that they need from being split up across the map. They're now starting to lose. They lost that last tier 2 tower. They're starting to lose their vision advantage. They're being readily counter-warded elsewhere. Newbie needs to do something to get themselves another one of those 5-man wipes, or at least a really good pick followed by some farm time, if they have any real hope of making this happen.
The only way that's going to happen is if they catch out LGD going for a counter initiation into Roshan, or LGD push. Like, that's the only way this is going to happen. Newbie can't force the engagement. You're still going up against a relocating Wisp, an Ember with spirits, a Prophet can TP around, and then two blinking heroes. So, Newbie don't set the position of this engagement. They're counter-initiators.
Yeah.
Maru's the one who doesn't want to get initiated on. Got to make sure he gets his BKB off during the fight. And in the gaps that he's having right now, either he needs to farm up enough to buy up a Crystallis, or he gets himself that Desolator he's searching for. If he's able to get either of these items, then you're good to go. It's the same kind of thing with Roshan. However, when you have this kind of stuff happen, you get a DD rune over on a Doombringer, and Roshan starts up, you need to get in there and stop it. But they're going to be too late because there's too much damage from LGD. The TA can see it, so they know what's going on. They just decide not to go.
There's no way they could have even gotten their heroes down there, right? They don't have the global initiation that LGD has. They're all spread out trying to get experience and farm. And they have lost all their Roshan initiation towers, which is what LGD was going for. They wanted.
They've lost Mu. The Doom's on him. Faith is making sure Mu can't just run himself away and with a Prophet ultimate. Man, they had to start all the way up on that top. The amount of damage that it just dealt to the TA. And with the Doom on her too, she couldn't go for Refraction, couldn't go for Meld. And that's a big blow to Mu. I'm talking about him buying up into a Desolator. Des will not help you. And then a slide of fist into the Searing Chains. There will be the double stun to come off there from the Lion, but that's not really going to do much. And they bring Faith into the middle lane. That was a relocate in. Hilariously enough, MMY is going to have to go back right now. But the jump in, whoa, Faith. That's nice and deep. Searching for the Centaur, and then Centaur finds them. Double on the Hawkstomp, goes for the double edge two. Faith, he's ticking down from the negative burn. The impetus damage flies out as well from Banana. Able to get that kill. He's trying to keep his friends close up to Rabbit to heal him up. The Scylla diving back past tower. He's got the Weaver bugs on him too. It's a lot of negative armor which is on him while Templar Assassin chasing some kills, finds him and why. He'll tether himself up now to Scylla, so now they're both in the same boat. And Mu jumps, Melt Strike hits on Scylla, keeps the negative armor there, and then Rabbit right behind him. He's not close enough to really get a proper Hoofstop. MMY, well, where is it? MMY is body blocking him. The Hoofstop will finally go, but Hal wants to get both heroes right now. Way! Jump out to a spirit. Wait, what? Oh, he's got an Invis rune. That's why he's body blocking. I was too far away, didn't actually see the animation on it. But Scylla's running back through the middle lane.
Yeah, that the stampede came up just a hair
too
late for them to be able to get back. Oh my gosh,
trap, stun, hex first. That's what had the range. Now they do still have stun. They got Finger of Death. So Sunshank, it's going to be Rabbit to start with. Meld Strike as well. Finger of Death not required. And they get through the Aegis, the Immortal, and kill off Scylla again.
And MMY sent packing back to his base. Actually, kind of being chased out by Banana, who's going to have a double damage rune. The teleport from Io into the mid lane with the Shadow Shaman who didn't have an ulti seemed kind of goofy to me. It seemed unnecessarily rushed, right? They put so much emphasis into getting Shadow Shaman these early levels of Mass Serpent Ward. You have them. You just used it on Roshan. You've got the Aegis. You have every little bit of map control you could ever possibly want. It really does seem like LGD was just being impatient. They want to get on to the next game.
At the same time, man, I think LGD feel like they're running against the clock. You are right about, like, maybe you do just wait it up until you get everything. But I think their primary concern is the fact that Mu is just going to have something big. And he's already got the Crystallis coming out in the Courier. Luckily for Newbie, luckily for Newbie, they've realized the Courier is going to walk underneath the Radiant Creepwave moving up through mid. So they turn it around.
Yeah. One thing that they did do is they did force out the buyback from the TA, right? So that really aggressive maneuver did force the TA to put a bunch of her gold into defending her base instead of buying something big,
but
which is nice.
She came down and got a couple of kills, so it made a buyback
right.
Worth it. So
exactly.
It wasn't that crippling to have that buyback happen.
It would have been much better if they'd forced the buyback and then just kind of backed out. But instead, they forced the buyback and still continue to push on the tower without the Serpent Wards. At this point in time, they have everything now. They still have a little bit of an advantage in terms of their overall gold. They're no longer sitting on a level advantage. They're very small amount, like a little over 2,000 experience.
Down, man. Yeah. Like, the Blink Dagger Doom, which you'd normally want to throw into Hal, you can't do anymore. He's got himself a Lincoln Sphere now. So he's quite safe, and then the Center Ollie, they jump out, they want Fate dead straight away. Finger of Death's gonna be committed as well. He's still got his Mass Serpent Wars down, which are up on the high ground of Newbie. It'll be a one-off trade for the Shaman as well as the Centaur. Sleight of Fist Searing Chain, Hal and Mu locked, but in July, well, okay, whoa! Too high up, way too high up. Try to go for the Sprout, but the rest of his team just left him for dead.
That is some interesting high ground maneuvering. Once again, Newbie pushing back. They managed to grab two kills here. Hal is starting to become a little bit of a force in and of his own right. He's got his Lincolns up now. He's got 2,100 gold on top. Mu now sitting on top of the Chrysalis, BKB, and Blink Dagger. LGD no longer have the advantage that they thought that they had and thought that they would continue to have for a little while. And I do realize that they were playing against the clock, but they, the clock runs quicker when you're dying four or five heroes at a time. Right, that's just the way it is. If you're trying to run against the clock, the worst thing you can possibly do.
The Doom's on Mu. They're initiating in again. Sunshine bought some space here for Mu. He's trying to get himself away in time. The relocate's on the way in. It's only an inch away, but the Nile, the Searing Chain, Sleight of Fist, it only goes into Sunshine. The Shackles will hold him there. They do actually bring down the Templar Assassin even while he's trying to run away. But Hal, in the middle of this engagement, still has time left. Haven't even triggered the Lincoln Sphere just yet over on him. But he will use the time-lapse nonetheless. He's got Shikuchi available. There's no Doom, remember. And then double Hoofstomp into the double edge as well. And maybe there is enough damage. The Meg Charge from LGD is enough life points, especially when they drag multiple spirits over the top of the newbie lineups. It's a double kill for Syla. Another Sleight of Fist of Searing Chain over on the Enchantress. And one attack, untouchable, makes it difficult. But it's a triple kill coming in for Syla. And they are looking pretty damn good to go high ground. Do they have? Well, there's no Master Serpent Wards. Actually, there is. He just can't get no. The front lines in time.
Yeah, there's just no caster, right? You got the Master Serpent Wards. You just don't actually have the Shadow Shaman. That being said, they already did a little bit of damage onto this tower, about half health. They should be able to knock it down with Treants. It's still full 20 seconds before the TA is back, which is really the hero they have to worry about. And you can see already the defensive Ember Spirits coming out here from Siler, getting ready to try and knock down this tower, get as much damage in on the Rex as they can, and then back out if it does not look like a favorable engagement. There are buybacks on the Centaur, who's not going to need it, and the Weaver, who might. The Weaver will probably try to wait this out, but in doing so, they are going to lose the Rex.
Yeah, no fortification available. The Fast Serpent was focusing on the melee, or even attempting to deny at the Rax at this point, but they've lost their entire mid. There's no other way to look at it right now for Mubi. And their advantage for engagements just became a lot worse. Because you've still got, like, even if Mubi pushed themselves back right now, they've still got even a T1 tower in the middle lane to get through, all the other tier 2 towers, and if they push out too far, you got a relocating Wisp that can just take the Shaman and his wards in, with an Aegis Prophet as well. And they will just beat down whatever tower they can find. I also love, too, that in July, I don't know if he stopped halfway through building into a Necro Book, but he's just got this casual belt of strength on him.
Yeah, you know, just a little extra something to give him that survivability. He's got the blade mail, right? So it makes sense for him, especially if he is going to go into a Necro Book. Makes sense for him to just grab that whenever he can to give them that little bit of extra tank. He does finish up his Mjolnir, which will also help with the push tremendously. And now that they've got a one high ground side out, they feel a little bit less like they're on the clock, right? They still obviously need to make sure that they can seal the deal rather than just negotiate around it. But Newbie is going to have a lot of trouble getting out and pushing down three towers in that lane where they do have their racks out while LGD is trying to split them down with the Ember Spirit, with the Io relocates, and with the Nature's Prophet.
Yeah, I was waiting for an opening in the bottom lane. The Prophet Oli was even committed just then to look for it, but Ember Spirit wasn't in the right position for it. He was too busy picking up his Daedalus. I love this aggressive observer. What? I don't know how much vision this thing gives. Actually, quite a lot. Kind of want to mark this one down a little bit more for the Radiant side, aggressive ward.
It gives this vision right here. Something like that.
It's seeing here. It's up through that line. It sees over towards this area and also sees down this little region here. In fact, this one even sees into the lane area.
Radiant structures
That's a really effective observer ward in a position which counter warding is next to impossible.
Especially with
the heroes there running.
We're going to see a little bit of a push down bottom. The other nice thing about that ward is it means that you don't have to defend this high ground ward, which is so commonly counter warded that you have to actually have heroes up there to physically defend it from being counter warded if you do want to go on that high ground.
Yeah, I was waiting for a position to jump in. Yeah, Genny wants to go on Mook because he knows that he's their damage dealer. But with the position they put the Mass Serpent wards without just cleaning off the wave to start with, most of those wards just got farmed up.
Yeah, they did get a fair amount of damage on that tower, though. Question is it worth giving that much gold over to your opponents in newbie if you're pretty sure that after two or three tries you're going to knock down that tower? Maybe you're even going to get the racks on it. I think LGD feel pretty comfortable at this point giving in a couple of Serpent Wards in order to knock down one more lane of racks. At that point, they're sitting on two lanes of racks while they still have all their tier twos up. In theory, should work out. The only problem with it is the only major advantage that they have right now is gold, and you can even see the impact that those Serpent Wards made on the gold chart. There was a little bit of a dip that comes out to about 1,000 gold, something like that, between the creeps and the Serpent Wards that were chewed up right there. They are still sitting at about 12,000 gold lead at 33 minutes, which is not terrible. LGD have a very small experience lead back in their favor, although that is a lot more of an EKG coming back and forth as newbie are able to split up or continue to get corked into their base. That experience will continue to either go in their favor or against them.
This for me is like newbie's last chance. That blink from Sunshine is going to be perfect and get multiple heroes on the stun, but with the Observer Ward that's up on the high ground, they see newbie's positioning. Sentry Ward is down as well, so Hal doesn't really have a place where he can hide here. The Treants from Nature's Prophet went up there, which is why newbie believes they're being watched, but they're being watched for multiple reasons. Sunshank locked in, the Finger of Death coming out, and the Relocate. Well, okay, that'll bring him outside the pit to fight up here. Moves the man that was doomed up in this fight, but Nana being chucked up. Faith so low on life points, he's running back inside the pit for the impenetrable kill for Sylar. There's just too much damage coming out from this Ember Spirit. Now, this is GG. This was their last major fight. They could have potentially won. They've already lost Arax. They'll lose the Enchantress in the river. The TA even bought back in this engagement too. So any hope that Mu was going to have a bigger damage dealing item with the security Jaegers to the Immortal goes completely out the window. LGD will take Roshan and they will take bottom Rax.
Yeah, not only Roshan, they're just going to leave the cheese on the ground, it looks like. No, Doom is going to drop his scroll of TP and pick it up there, just to make sure nothing sneaky comes out of newbie trying to get back down around and pick it up when they realize it's not an inventory. So honestly, it probably doesn't matter one way or the other. This Rax is basically undefendable at this stage. There's only one more buyback. It's on the Enchantress. The Lion should be back, but just about everybody for LGD is up in this. The Shadow Shaman will be able to be brought into the fight if necessary as well.
Moose considering a jump. TA trapped at slow. He'll need the Centaur at least to be able to contest this in any way, shape, or form. And at least this time he can get his BKB off. There's still a 10-second BKB that Mu hasn't used yet. So the jump in, there goes your BKB, but he realized he can't kill off Blade Mar Prophet, so then gets locked inside the Sprout, Sunsheng, a nice little Hex over on Sylar, but the Flame Guard's protecting him, and Mu just had to stand in the middle of the Sprout, get Slider Fisted down, got critted on the way through as well, and that's it. It's over. It's so over.
Yeah, that was as dominating a performance as game number one ended up being. Really just very, very strong push, especially on that one position Shadow Shaman that came out, got that very early tower. The lack of jungle creeps with the Enchantress. It all just comes down to the early game decisions that were made. It truly does. In a rare case, newbie just kind of loses it in the first 5 minutes and were unable to make the decisions and plays that they needed to make to come back from it.
Well, man, I want to see how it goes in game number three. One-sided on one game, one-sided on the other. Let's hope something nice and close, boys and girls. We'll be back here in a moment. Game number three, LGD versus newbie. Winner of this will go directly into their match up against Evil Geniuses in the lower bracket match. Of course, there's multiple games going on at the same time. VG Gaming still playing up against Cloud9 over on Joindota Blue. So Joindota, we are covering you for all the possible games which are coming out from WEC today. And there's actually even more games coming up tomorrow night, or I should even say tonight, I should say, with the MSI beat at Winners Bracket and Lower Bracket Final. That's coming up at midnight CEST, which is, well, roughly 14 hours away. So if you do want to watch that one, it'll be over on Jota to Red, and we're back for the WEC final tomorrow as well at 10:30 EST, even ESL1 on Sunday night, and we're probably doing a casual talk Dota. If you're a subscriber to the channel, you got a chance to call in and ask your questions to either myself, Cap, or whoever else is sitting here in the studio, and that'll be up after the WEC final tomorrow night. So for now, grab yourself a beverage, and we'll see you back here for Game 3 of LGD versus Newbie.